But I'm going to cut off our conversation. AV team is about to mute everyone. Good morning, friends in faith. It is good to be with you this morning. When I came up to the pulpit, I saw on my screen that there were 26 participants, which really means more than 26 of you, because there are often two or three of you sharing a computer window together. And so it's exciting for me to start my day with 30 some odd Valentines. I'm glad to be with my beloved community this morning. A few announcements before we begin our time of worship together. The first is that Lent starts this week. My goodness, it's early this year and it came fast upon us. Lent starts this week with Ash Wednesday on this coming Wednesday, the 17th. We are not going to do long distance ashes. I know some churches actually are doing that. But what we are going to do instead is offer a service on our YouTube channel, which you could also get a DVD of at the office if you let us know ahead of time. We don't want to spend the money on making more DVDs than we need, but we're happy to spend the money on making as many as we need. So if you're interested in our Ash Wednesday service on DVD, just let the office know, as some of you already have. Otherwise, you can access the Ash Wednesday service on Wednesday on our YouTube channel. Charity and I will be recording that, just the two of us, after worship today. We're going to let the AV crew go home and have their lunch, and Charity and I are going to go into the chapel and offer that for you in that way. Other Lenten announcements: the Lenten devotionals are available for pickup. If you haven't already gotten yours, you can feel free to come to the church any weekday morning. The back door by the parking lot there is typically open on weekday mornings as the community lunch program volunteers are in and out doing their work. So you're welcome to come to the church at those times to pick up your free Lenten devotional guide. There are still several copies left, and again, they are free. If you're not able to come to the church to pick yours up, or if you would like yours delivered to you for whatever reason, just let us know and we'll make sure that we get a copy into your hands when you do let us know about that. There are also several copies of the Upper Room devotional book still available. There are two different editions worth. We have the January-February volume and the March-April volume. So if you'd like to have those as well, again, those are free to anyone who wants to use them for your own spiritual life. When we start in on our Lenten series next week, we'll be reflecting on some of the work that many of you all did. A few weeks ago, I had you fill out a core values audit for me to help the leadership team discern best who we are as a faith community. Just like how each person has their own unique identity, each faith community has their own unique identity. And one of the ways that we can be most effective in our ministry throughout the community is by having a really keen and clear sense of who we are. So thank you to those of you who did fill out that core values audit. Our Lenten sermon series will be based off of the core values that the leadership team identified as being who we are. And so you'll hear about preaching and teaching scripture. You'll hear about worship and about prayer, about fellowship, and about encouragement, as those are really the things that make us most who we are as a unique and beloved community. And we'll talk about how those shape our work in the world and how those are shaped by our experiences as disciples of Christ. Of course, connecting all we do to the scriptures that we have. One last Lenten announcement. Many of you have been asking about our Lenten study series, whether we'll have a Lenten study series this year. Admittedly, I've been slow to get plans in place for that simply because I really wanted to revisit last year's series that we started before the pandemic started and everything shut down. But I could not figure out a way to work the technology end of that. There's a video component that's really central to the study, and I just, I couldn't, I couldn't sort it out. So what we are going to do actually is respond to a request from someone within the faith community to deeply study the Lord's Prayer. I'll be sending out an email in the next day or two and some letters for those who are not on email with some clear pieces about how and when we'll be studying the Lord's Prayer, but that'll be starting within the next week or so. So make sure that you're on the lookout for that. I think that's it for my Lenten announcements at this point. A couple of reminders about our engagement in the community. We are still a proud supporter of Family Promise of Ontario County. And if you are looking for a tangible way to support, you can do so by bringing in gift cards or monetary donations to be sent to Family Promise. There are other ways that gift cards can help the community too. A lot of times gift cards will be donated to me, to the church rather, so that I can disseminate them to those who I know have the most need within the faith community. And just over the last week or so, a few of you have done that, have brought gift cards for me to send out to those most in need. Grocery gift cards are the most helpful. And so if you are able to help within the faith community, or if you're looking to support Family Promise and their ministry, grocery gift cards are a great way to do either of those things. The community lunch program continues to operate at full tilt, offering bagged lunches that are handed out outside. And every Saturday, there's a lunch here that's provided by the Blueprint Geneva organization. And so we're pleased to be able to offer our building for use for all of those services. This morning we have some special music. In addition to the special music that Charity brings us every week, Cornelia is here with her flute and brought a friend named Stuart. Stuart Sewell is someone who's been here before with some ecumenical services that we've done, and he'll be playing guitar this morning as well. So we've got some extra special music coming later on this morning. Last note, if you have any concerns about tech-related things, if you can't see or hear what you think you ought to be able to see or hear, please direct those comments or questions to the AV booth. If you have any prayer requests or anything else pastoral that you'd like to communicate privately, please direct those messages to me via Zoom. Okay. I think that's enough announcements for one morning. I'm ready to worship, and so I invite you to join me in taking a breath, centering our hearts, and preparing to hear what God has to say to us this day. Beloved children of God, shout out loud, sing with joy, rejoice with gladness, announce that the glory of God is here. The glory of God is here. Amen. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, giver of life, your light shines in our lives and your glory is revealed through your Son, Jesus Christ. Reveal his glory to us as you did to Peter, James, and John, that we may be filled with his power and our mouths may proclaim his presence forevermore. Amen.
Introduction here. Good morning. As she said, I'm Stuart Sewell, and I appreciate the invitation from Reverend Hubie and from Cornelia to present an extra special music for you today. We thought, Cornelia and I kicked it around, we thought the best would be The Gift of Love. It's a wonderful reworking of a British folk tune by Hal Hobson, who's very, very talented. And then I kind of reset it just a little bit more to make it work on guitar. It's based on some lyrics. His lyrics are based on
a passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's called The Gift of Love.
Though I may speak with bravest pride and have the gift to always fight and have not love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless cane. Though I may give all I possess and striving so my love profess, but not be given by love within, the prophet soon turned strangely thin. Come, Spirit, come, our hearts control, our spirits long to be made whole. Let inward love guide every deed. By this we worship and are free.
Thank you for that. I told our musicians before worship started this morning that song was, that hymn was sung at mine and Dana's wedding almost 10 years ago. So it's a special one for me too. For our children's message this morning, we're going to talk about change. And so I wore my changing scarf for that. This is a scarf that my husband Dana gave me before he and I were even engaged. We were dating at that point. And on most days I wear it like this with the blue side out. But this is a reversible scarf. Let's see if I can do this with my microphone there. There we go. Got it. Didn't even move the microphone. Most days I wear it as a blue scarf, but some days I like to change it up. It's gold on one side and blue on the other. Sometimes I like to wear my hair down, but some days I change it up and wear my hair up. You've seen me preach with it both ways. See, there are lots of ways that we can change. We can change our appearance. We can change our actions. We've talked a lot about changing our actions, right? A few weeks ago, we were talking about repentance. It's when I learned that I can actually walk around and still stay in the frame of the camera. We talked about how repentance is changing direction. Repentance is what happens when we're walking away from God and then change direction and walk back towards God. So we talk a lot about change, even if not directly. Well, later this morning, we're going to hear a story about a time when Jesus changed, which is kind of crazy to think about. We hear things like God is unchanging and Jesus is steadfast, which is kind of a churchy, Bible-y way of saying the same all the time. And those things are true in some ways. But in other ways, there were times when Jesus changed in pretty big, dramatic ways, in pretty obvious fashions. In the story we'll hear a little bit later this morning, we'll learn about a time when Jesus took his three closest disciples, those student follower friends that he had, and he took them up to the top of a mountain, and they were climbing and climbing and huffing and puffing, and they got to the top of the mountain, and then he changed. some sort of change came over him that the Bible doesn't really have clear words for, except to say that he transfigured, which is a fancy word for saying his form, his shape, his body changed, and his clothes changed too. He went from wearing just normal hiking up a mountain kind of clothes to wearing clothes that were so dazzling white that no amount of bleach could have made them that way. That's more or less what the scripture says. And in this change, his disciples were changed too. See, when they saw Jesus like that, they knew that there was something even more extraordinary about him than all the other changes they had seen that had come from him. They had seen him change water into wine. They had seen him change sick people into healthy people. They had seen him change people's hearts and minds. Jesus had even changed their lives. They had been fishermen. They had been everyday workers, and now they were disciples of Jesus. See, when we're around Jesus, a lot of change happens. When we see the dazzling white, brilliant, bright glory of God, a lot of change happens. Change happens in our hearts. It happens in our hearts in a way that makes us feel peaceful, calm, safe, secure, even regardless of what's going on around us that would make us feel otherwise. When we're around Jesus, change happens in the way we look even, not necessarily in our clothes. Maybe we don't change from the blue side to the gold side and back because of Jesus, but we change the way we walk a little bit because of Jesus. Instead of walking kind of sad and slumped over and a little bit like Eeyore right after he loses his tail, we change. There's a tiggerish bounce in our step. There's a rooish joy in our faces, right? All these Winnie the Pooh references for the children among us. There's change that comes over us when we see the brightness of Jesus. So how do we see that? I mean, it's not like I'm gonna like walk out the door after worship this morning and like Jesus will be chilling in the front seat of my car. I didn't actually drive here anyway, I walked in this morning. But you get what I mean. It's not like we're gonna see Jesus in person in the same exact way that the disciples saw him. So how do we see Jesus to feel these changes, to experience these changes? Well, we find Jesus wherever we find love. There's a lot of talk about love today. Today is Valentine's Day, and so there are all sorts of hearts and cards and sweet treats and stuffed animals and flowers that go with that. There's a lot of talk about love today. Wherever we find love, we find Jesus. See, one of the things the disciples came to realize during Jesus' time in person with them was that Jesus was love in its purest form. If you could take something that doesn't have a body like love and put a body on it, it would be Jesus. Jesus was love in human form. So our challenge this week is twofold, two parts to our challenge. First, our challenge is to look for Jesus wherever we can find him. And that means wherever we see love, we say, oh, Jesus is a part of that. The Spirit of God is there somewhere. So if it's the love between the grown-ups who care for us and us, if it's the love between siblings, if it's the love that your teachers show you, well, you won't see your teachers this week because it's February break, but wherever you see love, remember that it's of Jesus and try to make a mental note. Try to say, oh, that was the time I saw love. That was the time I saw Christ. That's the first part. Find love, find Jesus wherever you can. The second part is notice how you're changed by it. Do you ever notice that when you're feeling kind of down or sad or even scared or angry, that when somebody shows you good, pure, Jesus-y love, it changes your heart a little bit? I know that that's true for me, and I imagine that's true for you too. So that's the second part. Notice how you are changed by love. Find Jesus wherever love is, and notice how your heart is changed by love. These are challenges that God's children of all ages can practice this week. All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for love. Thank you for Jesus, who is love. Help us be changed whenever we meet him. Amen.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is the story of the Transfiguration as told in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. But before we enter the scriptures, let's pray. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts express your love and change our loved ones for the better. Amen. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down from the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is a message from God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, like I said to the children a few moments ago, this is a story about change. It's a story about the change or transfiguration of Jesus. It's also a story about the ways that we are changed. Of course, many things in our lives change us. Relationships, births, deaths, illnesses, changes in job status, pandemics. Many things in our lives change us. And so today we're going to take a look at how Christ's presence among us changes us and how we respond to those changes. This is one of those stories that we hear every year. There are a few that just come up year after year in the liturgical calendar simply because they need to be told every year. They're just that important. And regardless of what Hallmark says, I would speculate that the Transfiguration of Christ is even more important than Valentine's Day. So we're going to focus on that today. See, this story is like many others from Scripture in that I don't know about you, I hear it differently every year. I read it differently every year. The Scriptures are the living Word of God. So let's jump into the story. First, let's talk about the basics, the where and the who. Where they were, who they were with to begin with, they being the main characters in the story. See, even these little details are significant, particularly in this story. This story is just bursting with intentional language and imagery that is rich with meaning. So where were they? Well, they were up high on a mountain. They were up on a high mountain. If we think back through the stories of scripture that we know and have learned, we know that mountains are kind of a thing in the scriptures. See, when Moses received the Ten Commandments, the law of the Lord, he received them up on a mountain apart from the crowds. There are other examples all throughout scripture. Jesus died on top of a hilltop, right? Calvary. I always say Calvary and cavalry mixed up. Jesus died up on top of a hilltop, regardless of whether I've had enough coffee to say the right word. These mountaintop locations are significant. They are places where people meet God. The top of Mount Sinai is a place where people meet God in the scriptures. This is connected with some ancient lore that's from surrounding cultures and communities that kind of made its way into the Hebrew community, that the higher up you get physically in the topography of the land, the closer you get to the heavens, right? This was the whole thing behind the Tower of Babel, that they were trying to build a tower tall enough to reach heaven. And so every time we see a story where people go up a mountain, and the author makes a point of saying that people are going up a mountain, we can assume that the author is wanting us to know that those people are ascending closer to God, that there's going to be some kind of really intensive God encounter there. So that's where. The next question we'll look at is who? Who went up? Well, it's just Jesus, Peter, James, and John, just the four of them. And the scripture is clear in saying they went apart. Apart. It wasn't all 12 disciples plus Jesus. There wasn't that 13-person crowd, nor was it a large swath of people that Jesus was teaching and ministering to, as we see in many, many other stories within the scriptures. They were apart. Just the innermost circle. This was meant to be an intimate encounter with God. This was meant to be a private faith moment shared just by Jesus, by Peter, on whom the church would be established, and by James and John, the innermost circle. Now, what about the event of the story, at least the main event, the transfiguration? There's speculation always about fantastical sounding stories like this in scripture. Was it like a dream or a vision that they had? Did it actually tangibly, physically happen? Does it even matter? The truth is that this transfiguration of Jesus was very real in the disciples' experiencing of it, and has a lot to teach us about who Jesus is and who we are in Christ. First is the word transfigured. We don't often take a look at that word in and of itself. And I think it's because it's one that we just kind of brush past, like Jesus was transfigured. Yes, we know this. We hear this every year. But if we think about the word transfigured, it doesn't say transformed. It doesn't say transitioned. It says transfigured. The figure of Jesus was changed. A physical change must have come upon him in some way or another. We don't know what that looks like. Did he grow 6 inches taller? Did he sprout some angel wings? What did it look like? We don't know. Except we do know that the author took care to describe the change that came not just upon Jesus' body, but upon his clothes as well. Mark says, Jesus' clothes became dazzling white, such as no one could bleach them. Dazzling white, brilliant bright. This is more significant than it seems on the surface. It's not just a metaphor of being washed clean, but it's that too. See, in prophetic language, we know that white is a symbol not just of physical cleanliness, but of spiritual cleanliness. That prophets of old would talk about how Jesus' blood would cleanse us white as snow. And so the clothes becoming dazzling white would have been a symbol, a metaphor, a visual image of perfection in spirit, perfection in faith, of purity of heart. But it doesn't end there. We don't know much about the clothes Jesus wore for most of the stories of Jesus, except for what we can assume from our historical cultural knowledge of what people generally wore in those days. We know things like he wore a cloak that time that the woman who had been ill for something like 14 years touched his cloak and he felt the power go out and was made well. And she was made well. But in terms of actually describing Jesus' clothes, that only happens three times in Scripture. We know that when he was a baby, firstborn in a stable, being laid in a manger, he wore bands of cloth. Swaddling clothes is what we hear now, but bands of cloth is really what the scripture says. We know that when he was first entering into the world, he wore whatever strips of cloth they could come up with at the time. We know that after Jesus' death and resurrection, the first sign of his resurrection that the women saw when they came to the tomb was a pile of his burial clothes neatly folded and empty of a body. And we know this, that at the moment when he was transfigured, his clothes became dazzling white. It's something worth paying attention to. We also know that in this transfiguration moment, there were two historical characters, fathers of the faith, that came and stood with Jesus. They were Moses and Elijah. And I love the way Mark tells the story that there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. I wonder if in their appearance they brought with them, I don't know, goblets of wine or flasks or whatever they used in those days. And they were just like, oh, hey, Jesus, what's going on? How's life on earth these days? You know, it's so very casual the way Mark tells the story, so very comfortable. And of course it is, because Moses and Elijah were the greatest prophet and the greatest lawgiver in all of ancient history. And now Jesus was the fulfillment of both. See, the scriptures tell us that Jesus came to fulfill the law and prophets, that Jesus was the culmination of all of the laws that had been given to God's people throughout their history, that Jesus was the fulfillment of all of the prophecies that had been foretold to God's people throughout history. And so it would make sense that Moses representing the law and Elijah representing the prophets would be the two who would come be on either side of Jesus. In this moment, in this transfiguration moment, the appearance of Jesus and those with him made it clear to the disciples that Jesus wasn't just some ordinary rabbi. Jesus wasn't even an extra brilliant kind of famous rabbi. Jesus was one who could be transfigured before their eyes. Jesus was one who was perfect in all spiritual manner of things. Jesus was one who was the fulfillment of all the law and prophets. Jesus was the Messiah. If there had been any doubt in their minds up until now, there need not be any more. Jesus was changed before the eyes of those closest to him. And just as significant change in someone we love impacts us, his disciples were deeply affected by the significant changes that they saw in and around Jesus. And of course, Peter did what Peter does. Peter is always the zealous one, right? Peter is the one that says, Jesus, if it's really you, tell me to walk on the water. And then he does it. Peter is the one that says, Jesus, I'm never going to deny you. I promise. And then he does three times. Peter is the one that likes to make a show of his faith. And so Peter is the one who speaks up first, and in fact, the only one who speaks up in this story. He says, Jesus, this is good. This is good stuff. We've got you. We've also got Moses and Elijah. Let's build some tents, right? Like let's make this last. But the scripture tells us that it wasn't just zeal that was driving Peter to say this. He was terrified. He didn't know what to say. Before Jesus responded, God responded. God responded in a cloud and with a voice and with language that echoes or reiterates the language used at the baptism of Jesus when a very similar sort of occurrence happened. God said, This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. It was almost as if God was speaking directly to Peter. It was almost as if God was responding to Peter's busyness and bustliness and desire to do something to mark the moment. And God was saying, shh, just listen. There's deeper wisdom in God's word than we often give credit to, which is ironic because they're the words of God. See, so often when we are met with change, we act like Peter. We become terrified or at least nervous and uncomfortable. And so we start bustling about, finding something to do. In our nervousness or discomfort or excitement, we build and fix and do and busy ourselves trying to find a place to put that nervous energy that change begets. But what if we heard the voice of God when God said, listen to Jesus? What if we learned the deep spiritual practice of being still and listening? Right now, in this moment, I wish you could be in this space with me. You could hear a pin drop in here. What if we recreated moments like these in our own busy and bustling lives so that we could listen to Jesus? See, when Jesus shows his brilliance to us, when God shows the glory of love made perfect in flesh to us, our call is not to respond by busying and bustling and doing. Our call is to be more of a Mary than a Martha. Our call is to be still and know that God is God. Our call is to listen to Jesus. And so, as we enter into Lent in the weeks ahead, may this be our first and foremost spiritual practice, collectively, even if apart. Through all the changes that happen in us and to us and around us, may we put down our hammers and fabrics and stop building tents and cooking meals and learn the deep spiritual practice of being still and listening to Jesus, the beloved Son of God. Amen. Beloved, as we prepare to come together in prayer with and for one another, there are a few prayer requests that I'll lift up this day that you have sent me throughout the week. One is for a community member, not someone in the congregation, but someone connected with someone in the congregation, by the name of Carol, who's battling some health concerns. There are a couple other community members that are 1 or 2 degrees removed from the congregation who are also battling health concerns. Their names are Sam and Blake. So we'll be praying for Carol and Sam and Blake, who are facing health challenges. I've also been asked to lift up a prayer for a beloved child of God, 2 beloved children of God who are deeply struggling with some personal and private struggles that God knows the need, we'll say. A joy that I will share this morning, first, is that teachers made it. Teachers made it to February break, and I know that my best friend, who's a teacher in a different district, is celebrating, and students are celebrating having a week of respite. Speaking of school, we celebrate with Caitlin, who made high honor roll again. We are so proud when the children within our faith community do excellent work, and so we celebrate with Caitlin on that achievement. Okay, those are all the prayer requests that I am aware of. I know that there is a birthday in the community today. We sang happy birthday last week to cover all the February birthdays. So Bruce, we love you. We're not gonna sing to you twice. All right, let's take a few moments to come before God in a time of prayer. God of grace and glory, we praise you for all that you are. You are perfect in holiness. You are radiant in love. You are the giver of every good gift. You are holy. We confess, O God, that we often fall short in loving, that we do not always love you with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, that we do not always love our neighbors as ourselves, and that many of us find it difficult to love ourselves as you love us. Free us, O God, from all the things that would hold us back. Free us, O God, from all the chains that keep us from fully embracing your spirit. We give you thanks, for we know that your freedom is available to us. We give you thanks, for we know that you have already forgiven us, that your mercy is abundant, that your grace showers upon us, that your love knows no bounds. We pray this day, O God, for those who are in special need of your love. For Carol and Sam and Blake, and for all others who are ill or injured, in mind, in body, or in spirit. We pray for Diane's family and for all others who are grieving. We pray for those who are living in fear. For those who are subject to violence. For those who are experiencing poverty. We pray for all who are subject to oppression or injustice. We resist evil, O God, and pray that you would give us the courage, the boldness, the faith we need to be justice workers in your world, that we might shape this world more and more into that which you dreamed it could be.
a place where all are treated equally and all can live freely, a place where all know your love. Change us, O God. Change us into who you want us to be, into who you know we can be, into who you designed us to be. We trust you with our very hearts. We trust you with our very lives. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Beloved, we proclaim Jesus Christ with our mouths, in our actions, and through our lives. So let us offer up our very lives to Christ, that in our lives we may be servants of Jesus Christ. One way we can do this is by giving of our financial gifts. Thank you. Lord Jesus, all that we have is yours, and all that we are is yours. In offering these tokens of our lives, may all that we do serve you to the glory of God. Amen. And now let us join our voices together across the miles in the prayer Jesus taught us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved children of God, get ready to serve the Lord. Go in peace and joy, sharing the good news of Jesus' transforming love and power for all. Amen. Have a good week, everybody.
Can I unmute? I certainly will. Nice job, Pastor Emily.
Thank you, Jane. It's good to see you as always.
Have a good week,
I look forward to seeing you every week, all of you every week.
Same here, James.